I'll try and sort of be in half an hour talk to you about synergistic image reconstruction. And so the aim here is to say we have a PET-NMR machine. At the moment, we've been reconstructing our RMR data. We've been reconstructing the PET data, but we haven't really exploited the fact that we have a machine that acquires both data roughly simultaneously. So to do that, I'm going to give you a one-slide recap on image reconstruction. So this morning, we were talking about all the MR physics and whatever, but in the end, we said, well, we can do something like least squares optimization of our to get the reconstructed image, where E was the encoding matrix in surf terminology acquisition model. X is the image that we want to estimate, and B was the data. I'm not 100% sure if Gustavo used B for his measured data as notation. And then similarly, Andrew talked about the PET reconstruction problem as an optimization problem, and looked at log likelihoods and maximum likelihoods and so on. And in the last few slides, looked at the using prior information, where there was an additional term there, which he wrote as U. And our likelihood was related to the probability of measuring some data given an image. Yes, the image was written as theta over there now. Andrew put you a lot of emphasis in trying to say, how does this formulation relate to the previous one? And that's probably kind of obvious. If you have a normal distributed model for your PET, sorry, your MR data, and you would take the logarithm of your Gaussian probability there, you will get exactly the least squares optimization that we're doing, or maybe weighted least squares if you have different standard deviations for different parts of your MR data. Yes? So really, a least squares minimization is the same as a maximum likelihood maximization for the normal distributed MR data. So these two are, on a mathematical level, the same. Yes, it is the same philosophy that we are trying to solve. So that's kind of important, because that means if we know how to solve one problem, a lot of the literature you can immediately apply to the other. And it's kind of interesting that often people don't realize that things get rediscovered in one field that already have been done 10 years ago in another field, because there's too many papers to read. But if you have a PET-MR machine and suddenly you think, ooh, we should probably read the literature. So the first bit here, I'm going to repeat a little bit of what Andrew talked about in the penalties, but give a bit more information on prior information that we can use, where we exploit the MR for PET image reconstruction. And then we say, well, if we can do that, then we can reverse things, or we can do many other things like that in a similar fashion. And then once we have that, maybe we can think about solving a joint problem where everything needs to be reconstructed at the same time. So that's the plan. So we start with PET reconstruction, because that's where all this stuff, I think, started. And they said, well, we have an MR, and that has wonderful edges and wonderful anatomical information, while our PET images are really very low resolution and very noisy. So can we exploit that anatomical information to give us better PET images? And so usually before we did that, then we said, well, okay, let's say we don't want to have too noisy images. We want to have our pixel values, neighboring pixel values cannot be just jumping around. Yes, we impose some local smoothness, and maybe we say, oh, but if there is an edge, if I try and see an edge in the image, I don't penalize too much. But if I don't see an edge, I will have a large smoothness prior. And so Andrew already showed you this, where you say, I have some kind of, the mouse lead doesn't work, I have some kind of a penalty or prior information, just the opposite view where neighboring pixel values, if that difference is large, I don't like it. And then you have some choices for what kind of function phi that we use there, and started off with quadratic function and try to do something else. And then you also have a choice on what weights you use. How far do you want to look? Do you just look at your neighbor, or do you want to look at two neighbors? So those are all parameters in all this kind of stuff. So now we say, well, but I'm sorry, we have an MR information. Wouldn't it make sense to try and use this? And obviously it does. So you can do that in different ways. And the probably historically first way was people said, if I have a brain, I can run a segmentation algorithm to tell me about different tissue classes. So I have my T1, I run GIF or whatever that you have, and you can then have gray, white, and CSF kind of classes. And then you also know for your tracer, radio tracer that you have, but what does it do in white matter? What does it do in gray matter? And so you can, once you know where gray matter is, you can put that in as prior information, obviously. So often it's the case that CSF, spinal fluid, will have no tracer uptake, yes. And white matter, often the tracer uptake should be uniform. While in gray matter, for many different radio tracers, it won't be uniform at all. It might show you the receptor density or whatever that you have. So how do we put that in then? If we have these segmentation groups, sorry. So the first thing is to say, if I know that I have a boundary between gray and white matter, then I'm not going to impose smoothness there. Yes, that makes a lot of sense. I say I want to have within white matter or within gray matter, I want to have locally smooth images, but in the edge, I don't want to penalize that at all. So you just set your rate to zero. That's an obvious thing to do. And then you can be a little bit smarter. So a map, put in the additional constraint that the radio tracer activity in white matter is supposed to be the same everywhere, right? And you can do that in terms of tissue fractions. Then you need to know how much each voxel, how much gray matter, how much white matter, how much CSF does it have? And you put that in as your model. So our normal PETO SEM image looks very blurry. This is an old image maybe, and we can do a little bit better, but nevertheless. And then if you use something like AMAP, you will not be reconstructing a single image, but you will actually be interested in the gray matter radio concentration. And then if you will also estimate the white matter, and from that you can go back to the original image if you wanted to. But it's obviously more interesting to just have the gray matter concentration. So I thought this was useful to give you an idea what kind of prior information you can put in there. Yes. Okay, so Andrew already talked about Darsha prior, so I'll just do this one, I think, relatively quickly. This is a slide from Johan Nertz, who his group evaluated this stuff a lot. So. They say, I don't want to have a segmentation because segmentation in itself is a difficult problem of parcellation. So it uses in a local neighborhood, it's going to look at your anatomical image, and it's going to find in this case, three largest differences. And it's going to say, well, those three largest differences, it's going to find the three smallest differences. And it says, well, if I don't have a lot of difference in my MR image, then I want to smooth that in the PET as well. While if you have a large image, I probably have an anatomical boundary and therefore I'm not going to smooth in my PET data. So you detect those on the MR image and then you set your weights that are on large MR differences, you just set them to zero. The advantage of this stuff is that you don't need to do any segmentation. But then you can do more. You can look at dictionary learning, which is sort of one of the older machine learning approaches, where originally this was all developed in computer vision, where you say, well, my image really consists of a sum of patches, and a lot of those patches are going to look similar. And so you create from your image or from a patient population or whatever, you create a set of patches and you say, my I can write every region of my image as a linear combination of those patches. The question is, how do you find your patches? So that is a little bit difficult if you do image reconstruction, but so what people generally then do is they say, I'll run a traditional image reconstruction, I now try and learn my dictionary, and then I rerun another image reconstruction, and maybe you iterate that, or maybe you do that from other data. So clearly, if you do that, you can also say, those patches are going to be related to my anatomical image that I have. And so that led to kernel-based reconstruction, where in some sense the patch or the basis function is derived from MR in this case, if we use PET as our PET reconstruction as an example. So I'll try and explain that one to you. So Andrew already wrote this equation. It says really our PET image, what we are after is the radioactivity distribution. We are not after a number 1 to 8 by 1 to 8 numbers, yes? And so you can traditionally do this in terms of little voxels, and you call your image a linear combination of voxelized basis functions, but you can use whatever you like as your basis functions. And people use blobs and whatever, but you can, for instance, one of the simple basis functions probably is just use a Gaussian. So as opposed to having a square type of basis function, you have something smooth, right? Now, that's good, because if you have a uniform region, then you can make your basis functions there a little bit wider, and in regions where you have sharp edges, you would want to make your basis function narrow. If you do that, it is kind of prior information that you give. Yes? So how are we going to decide this? Well, there are many ways, but one way to do it is to say, I have an MR, and I'll see where are there, again, large differences in my MR image, and I just weight my basis function accordingly. So this first term here is just a distance. If my from a center of my image element, I slowly decay away. Now you say, I'll make that decay faster if there is a large edge in my MR. And if there is no edge in the MR, I'm going to stick to the old basis function that I had. So it's a way to sharpen up wherever you detect edges in the MR. So if you then, this was all in continuous space, a lot of the literature writes this down in discretized space, so I thought I would do the same thing. So my notation lambda here is for a voxelized image, and you can then go from your basis function image to a voxelized image. That's what people traditionally, for display and for forward projection, whatever, that's what they want to have. But so all the rest of the formulas are just the same. Here the x's are your MR image sampled at the same resolution in this example, and you just use the same kind of formula. I hope that makes sense. Now, this has a potential problem that you might be over-smoothing now. If you don't have an edge in your MR, then you might say, oh, I want to have a really wide basis function. And that might be too much, because after all, your PET contrast and your MR contrast is not going to be the same. Yes, you might have a lesion or a metabolically active bit of the brain that doesn't have any contrast in your T1 at all. So what do we do there? So there's two solutions. You just make sure that your kernels are never very wide, yes? And you can tune that appropriately, clearly. And the other idea that people have used is to say, well, I'll try and detect PET images just like you would be doing with edge resolving priors, you can do that in your basis function as well. And they generally do this in an iterative fashion. So you say, I have a pet image reconstructed already. Does this have edges? Oh, yes. If so, I believe that those edges are correct. And you gradually move along that path, if you like. So the way to do that is to say my kernel is just the basis function, if you like, is just a product of two. I have my MR one and I'll take a pet one, which is derived from the previous iteration. And that gives you the formula that you can use for your pet one. You can use any one you like, but this is sort of the same as on the MR side. So it's a natural choice. Does that make sense? So what you have seen, obviously, is that there are various parameters sneaked into this problem. We have these sigmas here, which are the width of the basis functions. We also have a sigma that we have to use to say some kind of pet images, edges we believe and others we don't. And we have the same type of parameters on the MR side. And in principle, you can have those different for every voxel if you wanted to. Now, then you start to have too many parameters and we start to get a little bit worried. Now, that is something that, I don't know, 5 years ago or so, we all found a major problem. And then the community realized that, well, you can get those types of parameters from population information. And you can do that via machine learning, deep learning, and all of those things. So you can say, let me parameterize my priors with all these parameters. Now I have 100 patients. Let me try and train the parameters that I need to find that are optimal to reconstruct Alzheimer's patients with flora beta pair or whatever. Yes. The problem with all of that is that you need to have ground truth, but that's for the next lecture, I suppose. But in the literature right now, you will find not sigmas which are proxy dependent, you just find a fixed number. And usually people will say, if I scale everything, then this has to be one or something like that. Yes. Because otherwise it gets too much of a headache to have too many parameters in the problem. Okay, so this was all about, if I want to do pet image reconstruction, but I have an MR, how can I use this? But I can use that philosophy for any other type of reconstruction problem where I have side information from somewhere else. Yes, so the problem that we were solving is some kind of maxima posteriori or penalized thing, whatever you call it. So you have a data fitting term, which is the first one, and then you have a penalty term, which encodes my prior information. That prior information depends on the side information, on MR in the past. So there are other methods than the one that we just talked about. You can do anisotropic diffusion with different filters for depending on your MR edges and so on. So if you think about it and you generalize this, well, then we can use this for many, many different problems. And you find, I'm afraid I didn't write the references here, but you find lots of papers to try and apply that idea in different contexts. And from a mathematical perspective, that's a bit boring, but from an application perspective, it's very important that you evaluate how does this method work for my application. So you can say my site information could be a high quality PET image, while I now have a different tracer that is, for instance, very difficult to image or something like that. Or you say, I scan my patient twice, but I don't want to have too much dose to the patient, and therefore I'm going to inject less activity the second time around, but I'll use my first image as a prior to stabilize. Or you might be doing dynamic PET where you follow things over time. And then you can say, well, yes, but I have a good noise, almost noise-free image around if I just reconstruct one single image from all of that data. So that's called a static PET. And then you give that as prior information to your dynamic reconstruction. It's a little bit circular, but why not? The whole formalism just works. Or you can say, well, do this NMR, why not? I have arterial spin labeling, which we haven't really gone through to, but those images are nearly as bad as a PET image, let's say. And you have your T1 as a prior, so I can clean those ASL images up by giving T1 as site information for my reconstruction in exactly the same way. Or I might have very heavily undersampled MR, maybe you want to image very fast or something like that. And you could use your PET image as a prior, which is maybe a little bit crazy, but you can do it. I mean, the formalism is exactly there. Or you can say, well, I don't just have one MR image. I might have a T1, T2, diffusion weighted, whatever. And I stick all those in as site information in the same way. I'm going to have my kernels depending on all those different MR information or an ASL with PET and T1 and whatever. Yes. So all of this, the mathematics and the methods is exactly the same. So once you implement one of those into SURF, you can apply to many, many different problems because the syntax is the same for all of these problems. Yes, and the program will look exactly the same. Okay. So what about synergistic image reconstruction then? That's an interesting question there. So now you say, I want to. Okay, my animation didn't work here. So I don't just want to reconstruct my PET image and my MR image separately. My MR image might not be good enough to reconstruct on its own to act as site information for the PET. I want to do both at the same time. Yes? I might have a very heavily undersampled MR image that still can still give us anatomical information to the PET, while the PET might be able to remove aliasing or something like that on the MR side. And so there are generally two ways of doing that. The easiest one that we can all implement straight away is to say, well, I want to do a PET image reconstruction using my initial MR. Now I have an MR, I'll do an MR reconstruction using my PET as side information. Oh, now I have a better MR, I'll use my PET image reconstruction using that MR information and just go round and round. Yes, I say PET and MR, but it can be ASL and whatever. Yes, any of the previous things that we talked about before. So you just go back and forth in the loop. The other way is to say, as opposed to looking at it as two separate problems that I solve one by one, I look at it as one joint optimization problem. And I'll talk a bit more about that because that's maybe not so obvious. The first approach is very good, it's very easy to implement and gives very good results. The slight danger with it, in my opinion, is that you have to be slightly careful in how many times do you iterate here and how you can't run your reconstruction too far if you have a very noisy PET image that you are going to give as a side information to your MR, it's not going to work. So you have to sort of do a little bit of PET reconstruction, a little bit of MR, and gradually go there. But you can do that. So the joint optimization is a bit harder. You can do it in alternating fashion as well, but the formulation in itself is a bit different. So I thought I'd spend a bit more time on that. So we talked about the objective functions. The objective function was the log likelihood plus the prior information for MR, and we can do that for PET as well. So why not look at the sum of the objective functions as one thing that we want to maximize? And then we can have penalties or prior information on the MR, and we can have prior information on the PET, and we add that to our objective function. Now, if we leave it that like that, then optimizing that problem will just drop out into two separate optimization problems, yes? If there are no coupling terms between the x's and the thetas, then you can just well do them independently. But if you have something that says, my PET image is going to look like my MR image in some sense, then you suddenly, this last term on the right there, you have a coupling term between the two, and then you need to solve this problem as one big optimization problem. Yes? So think about it for a second. I'll try and find the MR image that matches my PET data, my MR measure data. I find a PET image that matches the PET measure data, but I'm going to do it such that my PET image is not crazy, my MR image is not crazy, and that they are related to each other. That's the last term there. Now, this is maybe a difficult optimization problem to do, and you can take up your drawer and of optimization algorithms, or you can say, well, this is fine, I'm going to do this in alternating fashion. I'm now going to do an MR reconstruction, and then a bit of PET reconstruction, a bit of MR reconstruction, a bit of PET reconstruction. And if you look at it, if you freeze your PET image, for instance, it's a pity that I can't point, but if you say, I do an MR reconstruction and the theta is constant, then those, the first and the last term will be a prior on my MR. So you can use your normal penalized MR reconstruction and similarly for the PET. So you can alternate. And so this setup is very similar to the previous options. And that's in practice how many. So the rest I'm just going to talk to you about a few different priors that for the last term that people have looked at. There's much more coming now with the machine learning literature and so on. These slides are possibly a little bit outdated. So it makes sense if we think about the previous things about edges and so on to try and say, well, my edges in some sense in my MR and PET have to be the same. Yes. And so how do you do that? Well, we just use the priors that we talked about before, essentially, in some fashion. But you want to be able to do it in a way so that you can influence your MR edges from PET and the other way around. So some of the priors that we talked about before, that's not easy to do, with others it is easy. So and a very easy one is to look at joint total variation, where you just say, I have a, you might know total variation tries to encourage sparse edges. So it tries to flatten the image everywhere, but concentrate any edges that it needs to have in a few places. So now if you do total variation on both PET and MR as a sum, it's going to try and put those edges in the same place. But it doesn't think, it just thinks about the gradient, but it doesn't think about the orientation of the edges. And then people looked at, well, you can look at the gradient of the PET image and the gradient of the MR image. If they are parallel to each other, that's fine, because then the edges have the same orientation. If they are not, I don't really like it. And so then that idea you can encode in different ways. So the parallel level sets prior looked at that by just saying, well, I'll measure the angle between the two gradients, and I'll call that my structural similarity. But other people looked at a slightly different way of encoding exactly the same idea by looking at the matrix of your gradients and looking at, I think this formula is probably not quite correct, but you can say, I look at the matrix of all the gradients that I have. I might have 6 MRs and 2 PET images. I stack them all up. And if I look at the rank of that matrix, the lower it is, the more aligned everything will be. So you can give that as your penalty. But the effect of that is more or less the same. So these are some fairly old now, 3 years old, results of looking at this with multiple MR sequences, but the literature on that is now fairly advanced. This is a five-year-old slide that we, our PhD student obtained, and I just put this one in as a word of warning, in a way. If you use synergistic reconstruction, you have to be wary that sometimes you, just like with any prior information, you might be giving the wrong information to the other modality, right? And so the one on the right is an example there. Really, there should be no inner circle in the top one. I guess the top one is the petimage, but it found an inner circle from the MR, right? And so that's not desirable, obviously. And now, if you would repeat multiple noise realizations, this is not going to happen, actually, but the eye sees. We try to enforce smoothness within the inner circle, but the edge itself is actually very noisy. Yes, and anything where you have edge-preserving priors, those edges are noisy. If you repeat noise realizations, those edges can shift a little bit. So, and so that's what the eye picks up. So that's not nice. The other thing that we had over here was that the synergistic parallel level sets prior is not convex, and so you can get trapped in local minima. So you have to be careful with all of those things. It's not so obvious. Now, again, the literature is huge, and although we started thinking about this in with PSMR and CT, people thought about this already for a while, and so you can have dual energy CT and now multispectral CT. And it's exactly the same concept. Yes, you just have one underlying object with different properties. Can I have priors? And if you look at the literature, a lot of it is the same. And now we know, and then we really talk to each other, but initially we didn't. Okay, this is one of the multi-sequence ones. I could have put one of the alternating approaches in here as well, but generally, ideally, you will find the same. So, why is not everybody doing this in a way? First of all, they didn't have the software, and now hopefully in a few months you will be able to do all this synergistic reconstruction stuff in SURF as well, once we get our alignment between our images all sorted out. But you already, once you say I'm introducing prior information and you have, that means you need to have extra parameters to worry about. And now we have even more parameters, yes? So the parameter tuning gets a little bit of a problem. And as Andrew already said, which parameters are best are going to depend for your task. So all those papers that look at one method for one particular task, they are crucial. Without them, you cannot use this. You obviously, with synergistic reconstruction, it makes sense to say my PET image will have an edge at an anatomical boundary, but it does make no sense to say those are the only edges that I have in my PET image. Yes? Similarly, on the PET side, on the MR side. So these images all contain different information, so you can't tune up your joint prior too much, because then they will all start to look the same. Didn't need to buy a PSMR machine. You also have movement. We think that they're simultaneous, and that's how these scanners were sold, but they are not. Yes, the time scale of acquiring MR data and PET data is very different. Gustavo talked about it takes time to sample your case space, and therefore you're going to have some movement there. It takes time to acquire PET data. We might have 1 millisecond information in our list node data, but you can't reconstruct the 1 millisecond duration PET image because we don't have enough count. So movement is a problem. On the other hand, movement is an opportunity because you can try and get movement from one modality and do something with that with the other modality. Nevertheless, there's huge scope for improved image quality with all of these methods. And therefore, we need to look at that, and we need to have more understanding. We need to find ways to set parameters, and I think the machine learning literature there is very useful. and we need algorithm improvements, and then you need to test this on your application. So for the testing, I think it's useful to be able to first do, I know one bit and I try and estimate the other. And I think extension to dynamic data already I talked about, but nobody I think has talked too much about putting synergistic information in image registration and image reconstruction, and you can do that as well. Okay, I think that's sort of what I wanted to talk about. Any questions? Yep.
So this kind of technique, like informing head chickens with MR, will work when the tracer object is uniform over the whole frame. In case of some traces like macro frame, where the uptake is only restricted to basically.
So the AMAP algorithm is specifically assumed that the tracer uptake in white matter was the same everywhere. But if that's not appropriate for your tracer, you shouldn't use AMAP. So generally, I think the prior information, you want to make it as correct as possible, and therefore it's going to be task dependent. So it does make sense to use something like Bowser or whatever with RecroPride, because you can find your striate and on the MR images, you have those edges there. But what you can't do is assume that the activity will be the same everywhere also. Sure. Yeah. So your prior information is really what it is. I know what this tracer or whatever does. I can use this for this application. You also had a question? No. In that case, I think it's up to Andrew to lead the way towards the future.
I think the microphone's out of battery. Does that have anything on the screen?
Nothing at all. So it's just a show.
Yeah. But you look great with it.
This thing tank is right.
Just the one on the left one.
Take an opportunity to jump up and